Okay, good morning. So I can actually hear myself today. That must mean that you can hear me. Are we okay in the balcony? Sweet. Great. Welcome back to CS125. This is too loud, I think. Okay. I'm going to take a good thing in. How is that? Still good? Okay. All right, so today we are at the point now in the semester where we're wrapping up our discussion of imperative programming. So this week is it. In fact, we might even start talking about object-oriented programming on Friday. Next week, so actually let me sort of do something unusual and go through a little bit of what's going on for the next couple weeks. So today, MP1 is due. Today, MP2 comes out. It's due a week from today. So it's the last in the early semester series of one-week MPs. And it's the last one that really focuses largely on imperative programming. Next week, not this week, this week we have a quiz. Next week will be the first midterm for the class. Not something to get scared about, not something to freak out about. We have lots of practice problems up for you to look at. Cumulative up to this point, covering imperative programming. It's just like a quiz. You sign up for it the same way, you take it the same way, you have the same amount of time. The material will be a little bit more focused on a broad overview of the first month of the course. The only difference of a quiz is it's worth a little bit more, like twice as much, and you can't drop it. Okay? Once we're done, at that point, as the quiz is out, as the midterm's out, we're going to start talking about object-oriented programming. We will continue the homework problems that week. We had a choice of whether to sort of, you know, I do want to create a little bit of space for you guys to focus on studying for the midterm. We are going to continue to start roll out those daily homework problems focused on object-oriented programming that week. However, we're going to hold MP3 for a week, so you won't have an MP out for the first midterm. That MP will come out the following Monday after the first midterm completes. Now, I just want to make sure that I'm not setting a precedent here, because I'm not making any promises about the second midterm. There's only so many weeks in the semester. This, you know, because of how things worked out and the schedule we decided to do for midterm two, it's possible we will have an MP out that week. We'll try to make sure we don't have an MP due, you know, like that week or right after the next midterm. We'll probably have, try to arrange it so there's an MP that comes out right as you're taking midterm two. Question? Yeah? You cannot see that slide. Oh, refresh the slide deck. Yeah, I just made a, sorry, if you can't see this slide, I just made these changes like 30 seconds before class. So just refresh the deck. So now that everybody has finally taken the first three quizzes, or everyone who's going to take them has taken them, I'm going to start today and Wednesday with just a little bit of review, looking at some questions that flummox people. So first question, we'll do quiz one today, and then we'll do quiz one on Wednesday. Again, this will be kind of a good chance for us to look at some of these things before the midterm exam. So this question, so this gets at a really important, you know, a programming concept. I think some of you are starting to learn this because you're doing the MPs. But if you look at this piece of code, what is wrong? What's wrong with it? Yeah. Yeah, so variable on line 5, I'm accessing the variable called second, which was declared inside the block that starts on line 2 and ends on line 4. So when I get to line 5, that variable is out of scope. So this code won't compile or run. This is one of the, you know, and again, this is one of the reasons why we're encouraging you now, sort of forcing you using check style to write your code using proper indentation. This makes it so much easier to read and so much easier to see scoping issues like this. You see, oh, okay, I've left that block, so now I've dedented out towards the left. I can't use second anymore. Second was declared inside the block. I'm trying to use it at a vertical position that's left of where it was declared. Right? If you don't indent your code, this becomes impossible to read. Right? Impossible to see problems like this. Okay. Next review question. How about this one? Again, something that I suspect maybe a few of you have already tangled with on one of the homework problems or maybe on an MP. What's wrong with this piece of code? Yeah. Oh, it's initialized twice, but what else? Yeah, over here. Yeah, so here's the problem with this piece of code. It will work. You can run it. The result of setting I to 5 is the new value of the variable. So that will evaluate to 5. Is 5 true? It is true. A non-zero value in a conditional statement is considered true. So this can be very, very hard to fix. As you're looking at it, you're squinting at it. IntelliJ will help you. IntelliJ will flag this, and it'll warn you. It'll say you're doing an assignment inside a conditional. What's wrong here is that on line one, I'm saying if I equals 5, but I'm actually doing an assignment. I'm not testing equality. With equality, I use the two equal signs. So again, this is a place where using an IE like IntelliJ is going to help you out, because it's going to see this, and it's going to say that's probably not what you wanted to do. This is probably a mistake. Okay. Last one. So for some reason, a lot of people got this question wrong, which I thought was funny because I should have looked at which one of the other answers were popular. So why is the ASCII value for character K 107? Is this something that, like, we received from aliens, some sort of alien intelligence that's far greater than our own, like, beamed down these instructions, or, like, some religious figure went up to a mountain and came down with some stone tablets that had, like, K 107 next to it or whatever? Is that what happened here? Why is this true? Yeah. Yeah. Some bozo sat down in, like, the 1960s and wrote out this table, and now we're kind of all stuck with it. Although, as we pointed out, we actually are moving on to a richer way of encoding characters that allows us to incorporate text from all of the major sort of languages of the world. So in Unicode, I have plenty of space for pretty much every single character that I could possibly imagine in every script that we've ever used. Unicode also allows us to do stupid things like have inverted characters, emojis, which are not a language yet, although they seem like they're kind of maybe on their way to becoming a full-fledged language. Anyway, so this is just a convention. And we'll come back and we'll talk about conventions again repeatedly throughout the term. Okay, so the new idea we're going to talk about today, and you're going to start to see on the homework, you're going to start to see on MP2, you're going to see again on MP3 and then on MP4, is one of the other data structures we're going to work with in this class. This is called a multi-dimensional array. So arrays in Java are pretty great. You guys have been working with them. We're going to talk about some other array-like primitives once we start talking about objects and collections, but arrays are sort of limited in the sense that, you know, a simple Java array stores one-dimensional data. And a lot of data in the world is not one-dimensional. In fact, I would argue that most of the data in the world is not one-dimensional. It's very, very easy for information to acquire a second dimension, even if the dimensionality in that dimension is small. So here are multi-dimensional arrays in Java. They look pretty similar to what you've already seen. So on line 2, I'm initializing an array called samples. It's of type int, and it's a one-dimensional array. On line 6, I'm initializing an array of type character named board, and this is now a two-dimensional array. You see, in the declaration statement, I have two sets of square brackets. So when I declare an array, that indicates the dimensionality of the array. On the bottom, and I can extend this out as far as I want. In Java, I don't know if there's a limit, actually. I mean, at some point, it becomes unwieldy to work with them. But on the bottom, I'm declaring a three-dimensional array. Certainly, I could declare four-dimensional arrays without a problem. Now, on the right side of these declarations, we see that common array syntax we saw before. But as you might expect, when I declare a multidimensional array, I not only need to tell Java how big the first dimension is, but I need to tell it how big the other dimensions are as well. So this declares a multidimensional array of size first in the four dimension, sorry, of size 4 in the first dimension and 8 in the second dimension. On the bottom, I have an array of size double, this is a three-dimensional array. It's of size 6 in the first dimension, 8 in the second dimension, and 10 in the third dimension. This is a fairly straightforward extension of what we've already seen. So multidimensional arrays in Java are interesting because what they actually are is that they're an array of arrays. So up here at the top, what I can do is I'm declaring on line 2 an array called samples, and it's two-dimensional. I can see I've got the two sets of square brackets. It's got size 4 in the first dimension and size 8 in the second dimension. On the bottom, what I can actually do is I can take a, this is sometimes called a slice. This is a slice of the array on top. If I take the first element of the first array, samples is a two-dimensional array. If I dereference the first element, what I get back is an array, a single-dimensional array. So I've sort of chopped off one of the dimensions of samples, but I can actually work with each array inside of it as if it was a single-dimensional array. If this was a three-dimensional array, then the array that I would get back on line 5 would be two dimensions. And then I could do the same thing there. I could take the first element of it, which would be a one-dimensional array. One of the things that this means, and I hope I have this on a slide, but we'll get to it, is that in Java, arrays don't, multidimensional arrays don't have to be square. A Java array can have, be of size 4 in the first dimension, 2 in the second dimension, 3 in the third dimension. So each array inside of it can have a different size. That's not particularly common, but it can be done. All right, so let's play with these a little bit. So I've got, I've got my samples up here. So let's put in a println. So what do we think this is going to print? If this was a single-dimensional array, what would it print? Well, let's do this. Let's say that, let's create samples. Let's change the declaration to be a single-dimensional array. I'm going to get rid of this because this isn't going to work anymore. So what's this going to print? 5. Yeah. Good. Now, what if I do this? Now, the first thing I need to do is actually I need to declare a two-dimensional array. What's that going to print? What do you think? It's going to print 5. Yeah. Because that's the size of the first dimension of samples. What if I wanted to print off the size of the second dimension of samples? What would I do? So this is interesting. Let's do this down here. So now I'm accessing the one-dimensional array of ints that's stored in the first, at the first index in the first array of samples. What's the size of samples slice going to be? Let's print that out. What do we think that's going to be? Make a bold prediction here. 10. Yeah. Questions about this? So in this case, let's do some looping here, actually, just for fun. So let's say, so I can loop through a multidimensional array just like I would a single-dimensional array. But instead, let's do system.out.println I, and then we'll do samples i.length. All right, so what do I think is going to happen here? How many times is the loop going to run? What's the dimension, what's the first dimension of samples? 5. And then what's it going to print for the length of each of the second dimension array? 10, they're all 10. All right, so let's check this out. Yep. So I see I went through 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 times, 5 times. Every time the samples, the subarray that I'm dereferencing there has length 10. Okay, let's go on here. I can also initialize multidimensional arrays the same way that I initialized a single-dimensional array, using this syntax with the curly brackets. Now, I want to warn you about something, which is that this becomes extremely unintuitive extremely quickly, okay? Particularly because some of you, at some point in your young lives, have been infected with this idea about how two-dimensional things work. Some of you have heard this word called row, and you've heard this other word called column, and you've somehow acquired the idea that these are important ideas, and that they are meaningful when we talk about two-dimensional arrays and we program. I'm here to tell you that that is false, and that those words, you know, if you could, It's like I watched that movie recently, Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind. How many people have seen that? So this guy goes in and has this treatment where it's essentially supposed to remove all the memories of this bad relationship he's had. So if I could have that for you, where I could remove row and column from your brain, I would do that. But for now, you're just going to have to ignore that intuition. The problem here is that the visual layout of the array initialization here does not necessarily map up very well with where the values are in the actual array. Okay? And you guys will tangle with this to great frustration on MP4. And of course, you can also ask yourself, if I needed to initialize a three-dimensional array, then I'm in trouble, because I've only got two dimensions in space in my code so far. As far as I know, and no one has tried writing a programming language that actually has three dimensions, but that would be kind of interesting. So I have to write static initializers to do three-dimensional initialization, at which point, you know, your visual intuition is just totally gone, right? But this statement, so with that caveat and with a slight bit of trepidation, this statement from 1 to 4 is equivalent to doing the following. So it's equivalent to creating a new 2x2, two-dimensional array of integers, and then initializing each value one by one. You'll see here that this syntax with the brackets is very similar to what we saw with the single-dimensional array. That's how I dereference a particular member of a two-dimensional array or a three-dimensional array. All right, so again, if I print, oh, there's a missing semicolon here, and there's also a missing comma. So here's my question. From looking at this, what do you think this is going to be? So the one in the upper corner is 1. What's the value in the first subarray, the second value? What's that going to be? Anyone want to guess? I actually don't know. Let's find out. 2. Okay. I guess that makes a little bit of sense. What's that going to be? I think it's going to be 4. Okay. So like I said before, try to forget as much as you can about rows and columns, because those are just going to mislead you. These aren't spreadsheets. Some of the intro CS classes here actually have to teach people how to use spreadsheets. I'm really glad I don't have to teach that class. This is not business school. You guys are programmers. You already know far more about how to actually build and use these tools. But again, this intuition that you've acquired that you think you're going to apply to this problem about rows and columns is really deceptive. And of course, rows and columns also breaks down completely when you start to deal with higher dimensionality data, like three-dimensional data or four-dimensional data where you can't even visualize it. Okay. The idea here is that the semantics of the array indices in a multidimensional array are totally up to you to define. We're going to talk in a minute about some examples of multidimensional data, but you can already think about, you know, the position of something in space. So if you want the first subarray to hold the x coordinate and the second subarray to hold a y coordinate and the third to hold the z coordinate, and you set up the system like that, then that's what it means. And when you're using it, you just have to remember that, right? That, you know, this is how this works. All right, so probably should have talked about this before. So what kind of data works well in a multidimensional array? Give me some examples. Yeah?
Like images?
Images, yeah, classic, right? Classic data that's stored in a multidimensional array. I have one dimension for each dimension in space, and then each value inside the array holds the color at that position, or the color that was measured by the sensor or whatever is going to be on the screen. What else? Back.
Coordinates,
yeah, like position. The position on the Earth. Is that two-dimensional or three-dimensional? Three-dimensional, maybe even four-dimensional. What's the fourth dimension? What's always the fourth dimension? You guys have to take physics, right? Time, yeah. So imagine something moving around. At every point in time, it has a position, but I also have a temporal dimension, right? So a four-tuple, right? Time, x, y, z coordinates. What else? Yeah. Way in the back. What's that? Yeah, math.
And please don't forget about rows and columns, because that's actually
No rows and columns, right? Yeah. So in math, right, we store, you know, matrices, right? We do transformations based on, you know, two or three or higher dimensional data, right? A lot of the math that you do in physics or other places to, you know, transform coordinates or understand how things move or understand how things interact with each other is done based on this type of data. All right. One that nobody mentioned, I don't know what this is. That's interesting. I don't remember what the reference for that is. Oh, that's a picture. That's what that is. Okay, that's nice. You know, so here's some sort of model, right? This is actually like four-dimensional data, right? I've got three dimensions shown by using a false sense of perspective, and then I have a fourth dimension shown in color, so that's kind of cool. This is one of my, there's one of my favorite forms of data here. So I don't know what it is about, like, I know that your generation likes music. I get that, right? You guys have some good music that's coming out of your generation, not as much as I would like. But you do realize you have two ears, right? So a lot of people, we have a lab coming up, we're going to work with audio data, and a lot of people are kind of like, really? It's two-dimensional? It's like, yeah. There's one track goes in here, one track goes in here, and they're actually different. Has anyone noticed this before? Like, take off one ear and see what's going on. The process of audio engineering that goes on, this is why different recording artists sound different from each other, right? This is how, you know, when you listen to a particular song, a particular instrument sounds like it's coming sort of from over there, right? Audio engineers use these tricks with timing between the two audio tracks to create a sense of space, right? That's what creates, you know, the difference from, you know, a band that sounds like it's recorded in a very claustrophobic room to one that's got a lot of reverb or, you know, the positioning where you put instruments, you know, within the audio, sort of within your audio space, right? Is the fact that there are two tracks. If you go to a movie theater, there might be 8 or 10 or 12 different tracks. One coming from under the stage, a bunch of speakers sort of independently powered along the side, some ones in the back, a separate subwoofer that's used to provide bass. All right. So these are the type of things that we use in multidimensional arrays. And again, once we have arrays and multidimensional arrays, we can actually work with a lot of different types of data, which is pretty cool. So one of the things we're going to start you guys off with this semester and this week, excuse me, is this idea of using multidimensional arrays. So when we talked about arrays, we talked about the fact that a frequent use of a for loop was to go over every element of array, to do some sort of processing or some sort of computation or some sort of calculation that involves either modifying or incorporating the value from every element in an array. For a two-dimensional array, I can do the exactly same thing. I have an outer for loop, and it's common to use certain indices to do this. So I for the outer loop, J for the inner loop, K if you need another inner loop. If you get to L, then there's probably something going wrong, right? Talk to a TA at that point. But, you know, so what does this loop do? The outer loop goes through each element in the first subarray, and the inner loop goes through each element in the second subarray. If that element is an actual primitive type at this point, we're done. If it's an array, then we need another loop. Yeah, question. That's a good question. I think the answer is yes. Yeah. The question was, can I use the enhanced for loop with a multidimensional array? We'll try it in a minute. Yeah, I think so. Okay. Well, actually, no, before we do this, I'm just gonna blow this away. And let's look at, you know what? Sorry. Follow me, and let's go back to, you guys are gonna get all angry now because. All right, so let's go back to this example, and let's iterate through this array. So I'm going to write one for loop here, and then I'm going to write my inner for loop. I'm going to use J for my next index. J goes up to samples i.length. That's the length of this particular subarray. We will talk about why that's important in a minute. And then let's do this. Let's print off. We'll print I. And try to make this a little bit pretty. So I'll print off the coordinates first. And you can see that I go through, I'm starting, you know, my outer loop is going through the I values, and then the inner loop goes through the J values. So the I values in here are the ones that I'm using to access the first subarray, the J values are the ones I'm using to access the second subarray. So what's the size of the first subarray of this particular of samples? 5. What's the size of the second subarray? 10. So my outer for loop runs once with value 0. The inner for loop runs 10 times with value 0 to 9. Then the inner for loop completes, and I go back to the top of the outer for loop and start again. And I do this until I'm finished. If I wanted, I could set the value of samples ij here. Let's set it to I plus j. Let's do this. And then, for fun, let's write the same loop, and we'll print off the values after we set them. So we'll do. All right. Yep. Okay. Questions about this before we go on? So in this case, let me make a small change here, and you guys tell me if this is okay. Can I do this? So what's the difference here? Yeah. Well, when I look at the length, when I determine how many times that inner loop's going to run, I'm only ever looking at the length of the first subarray. Is that okay in this case? Yeah, so in this case, and this is something that we will draw out on some homework problems this week. In this case, I've initialized a square array. A square array. Where the first, you know, 5 subarrays, and every one of them has size 10. But that's not required in Java. In Java, the first subarray could have size 10, the second one could have size 8, the third one could have size 6. So if I know I have a square array, I'm really having a hard time saying that today, I can use this shortcut. If I'm not sure, then it's always safer to look at the length of the particular subarray that I'm about to iterate over. And again, we will give you some practice at this on the homework this week. Yeah?
Shouldn't you be saying rectangular arrays?
Yeah, that's true. Rectangular arrays. Good point. It's not, and that would be easier for me to say, I think, right? Rectangular arrays. Yeah. They don't necessarily have the same size on each dimension, but each array doesn't have different sizes. Okay. So let's do a little example here. That'll be kind of fun. All right. I was informed last semester that not everybody knows about a game called Tic-Tac-Toe. I suspect many of you have heard of Tic-Tac-Toe. How many people have heard of Tic-Tac-Toe before? A game called Tic-Tac-Toe. Okay. If you haven't, a quick explanation. It's played on a 3x3 board. There are 2 players. Every player has 3. Is it 3 or 4? I guess you can play as many times as you want. One player has an X that they can put down in any spot. The other player has an O. The goal of the game is to place 3 of your symbols in a row. So either, you know, up and down, diagonally, along any vertical or horizontal array. So let's write, and this is, you know, this is a classic case of something that we use an array for. A lot of games, including one that you're going to work on for MP3, use arrays to represent the state of the world. Tic-tac-toe is no different. I can represent the state of the game as, in this case, I'm initializing an array of characters. Now, I'm doing something here, which is that I'm using a special value to indicate that nobody has played in that position. Can you guys see what that value is? I'm using a period. I could use a space, but a dot is a little bit easier to see. So I've got this, the current state of the board, and you can imagine if you were building a tic-tac-toe game, every time somebody played, every time someone made a move, you would need to check the board to see if that person had won the game. Is the game over? Has somebody managed to put three in a row? All right? So, let's think about how to do this. I'm going to write a piece of code to do this. And we'll only write it in one dimension, because it's fairly easy to write in the other dimension. And for the purpose of this example, we're not going to worry about doing it diagonally. We're just going to look, you know, in the first subarray vertically and horizontally. So how do I do this? Who wants to... Well, what do I know I need to do? Just talked about this sort of canonical thing that I might need to do with an array. What do I definitely know I need to do here? In order to see if somebody is one, I probably need to do what? Yeah? Yeah, so you're getting a little ahead of me, but what construct do I need to do here? In order to do that, I have to iterate over the entire array. Yeah. So let's write that loop, say, and we'll use current board.length, i++, and then we'll say, in this case, I know that the array is rectangular, so I don't necessarily, I could just look at the first subarray each time, and let's just print out the value of current board ij. Oh, I'm an idiot. Okay. Board. Yes, it should be board. Board. Oh, and it's mad at me. Okay. So you'll see here that I'm going through and I'm printing off the value of the board. Okay? So now, what's my algorithm here? So now I've got the loop kind of set up, ready to go. But what constitutes a winner? What has to be true about the board in order for there to be a winner? Yeah. Can I move the what? How am I going to do this? I need three in a row. So if I need three in a row, what has to be true? One way to think about it is, what has to be true about the second and the third element of every subarray? They have to be the same as the first. Yeah. So let's do this. We're going to cheat a little bit. We're going to say first is equal to board I 0. So that's the first token. And then I'm going to say if board I 1 is equal to first and board I 2 is equal to first. I actually don't even need this loop. Return first. So this approach clearly would not work if I wanted to play tic-tac-toe on a much larger board. This statement on line 8 is exploiting the fact that I know that the board only has size 3 in both dimensions. So taking that, you know, sometimes when you're working with small arrays in Java, it's a little cleaner to do something like this rather than to write another loop. Once the array gets big, I wouldn't do it this way, right? If that if statement had to have like 8 checks in it, at some point, I would write a loop. But we're working with small boards, so we're okay. So one thing that's wrong with this. There's a bug in this piece of code. What is it? All right, so let's print the result of this. Okay. So So the question is there a winner right now? I don't think there is. It looks like XOO, OXX, period, period, X. So let's change this one to OOO. Okay, so that looks like, oh, I remember. So there's two problems with this piece of code. What's one? Yeah. Yeah, so I'm checking to see if any of the characters are the same. So the dot character is special. That means that there's no winner. And so if there's a dot, I don't want to return that. So what I can do here is I can say if first is equal to dot, I'm just going to continue on to the next row. All right, so let's try this with something that I think should have a winner. Okay. Seems like it worked. So in that case, I had a winner right at the beginning. Let's change it so it doesn't have a winner anymore. Let's put a winner in the second subarray. Okay. Let's break that one. And let's make sure that we're not returning the wrong winner. So in this case, my second subarray has something that I might mistake for a winner. It's three dots. But because I have that statement on line 8, I'm ignoring that. And so I get all the way down to the third subarray. This is not a complete solution even for what we set out to do, right? Because here I should have a winner. I have an X in the first position in the first subarray, an X in the first position in the second subarray, X in the first position in the third subarray. This should be. This board should be over. My algorithm is not going to find it. Oh, it did. Oh, sorry, because of this. Yeah. There we go. Okay. What's wrong? What would I need to do to complete this if I wanted to check both vertically and horizontally? Yeah. Yeah. And I will leave that as an exercise for the reader or the viewer, probably something that will appear on a homework problem this week. All right, so I've done this for one direction through my array, either vertically or horizontally, it doesn't matter. I need to repeat the process so that I check both vertically and horizontally. Questions about this? We will give you lots of practice this week in working with two-dimensional arrays. Yeah. What's that? Yeah, great question. Why does the dot show up? Maybe that helps. Yeah. So I could also, instead of returning a dot, well, I have to return a character. So you'll see here that I'm falling through to the bottom. So I have to return something. If I don't find a winner at any point, if I find a winner, I'm going to return immediately on line 12. So that'll immediately return from the function. If I don't find a winner, and I've iterated through all the subarrays, then I hit the return statement on line 15. That's only in the case where the algorithm is not able to there was no winner at that point. Okay. So just, I don't know how many of you know this. So tic-tac-toe is something that's referred to in computer science as a solved game, in the sense that a computer can play tic-tac-toe perfectly. And if I remember correctly, I think the idea with tic-tac-toe is that if you go first, you can always force a draw. I can't remember. Someone can look this up for me. It's not a particularly interesting game, let's put it that way. There's a strategy, unless you're playing with like a child or something, and you want to feel good about yourself. There's a strategy that you can follow, even if you're the second person to move, that will guarantee that you at least can force a draw. But I think maybe that requires that the first person not move in the right spot. Anyway, you guys can look this up. Okay. So for the last 10 minutes, I'm going to do something new. So something we're going to try this semester. We'll see how this goes. So on Friday, you had a homework problem. And that was probably one of the more difficult homework problems that we've given out this semester. Which is good, because today what we're going to do is we're going to talk about it. And my goal here is, so here's how I approach this. Throughout the semester, you guys are going to work with us, you're going to work with the CAs and the course staff. But the problem we have is as follows. We give you test cases and test suites. Those check the logical correctness of the code that you write. But it still leaves us unable to examine your code to see that if whether it is truly wonderful. There are ways of solving these problems that will pass the test cases, that will not get you a job, or will not lead to future success in computer science, because they are, you know, they are not beautiful. They are not sort of, they don't demonstrate an understanding of some of the fundamental principles or idioms that are at stake here. Right? So as people have been sending me code on the forum and sending code to the staff as we've been looking at it, you know, I've seen a lot of, you know, misconceptions. There are bad ways of solving these problems that will get you full points. And so what I'm going to start to do, and we might start doing this live with some of the programming exercises we do in class, is I'm going to take some examples generated by you, and we're going to look at them together. We're going to talk about how could this be better. You know, in some cases, we're going to look at examples that are actually very good. In other cases, we're going to look at examples that need some work. One thing I want to point out today is that all of these, all of the couple that we're going to look at passed the test suite. So these were ones that were considered correct by our grading tool. But when I look at them, I think, again, if you, so, because here's what's going to happen. When you interview to work at a technology company, they don't, you know, at some point they're going to process some of your information with some sort of computer program, but at some point you're going to sit down with somebody, frequently, you know, side by side at a terminal, or over the internet using Google Docs or something like that, and they're going to ask you to solve a problem. They're going to say, okay, you know, rotate a string, right, by a certain number of characters. And you're going to have to do that. And the person evaluating your code is a human. So if you write something that works, but is, you know, has a lot of unnecessary parts, the person that is interviewing you or evaluating you is not going to think that you know what you're doing. And so this is also the thing I want to challenge you as we go through the semester. Just because you passed the test suite, and I know, you know, you might have been working on this problem for an hour, and it's like you got something to work, it passed the test suite, okay, I'm done, I'm going to dinner, I'm going to bed. But you're not always done. Try to make it better. And particularly when you start reviewing for the midterm, you guys can talk about these problems on the forum now once the deadline passes. You know, post your code and say, hey, is this a good solution? Is there any way for me to make this a little bit better? So I'm not actually going to post these aren't posted as part of the slide deck. I'm just going to grab them and sort of paste them in. So let me make something really clear here. My goal is not to make anybody feel bad. All right? If you think this is your code, maybe it is. And you're getting a really special lesson from the teacher today, right? It might not be your code, too. I mean, we get lots and lots and lots of solutions. A lot of them look very similar, right? So it's possible that you and somebody else had a similar way of solving the problem, right? But again, I'm not going to identify you now. You know, I'm not going to ask you to identify yourself. The point is to, you know, go through an example of taking something that works and seeing if we can make it a little better. Okay, so let me grab my first one of these. All right, so here was, that's not what I wanted. Still not what I wanted. Copy, paste, bingo, okay. So here's a solution to rotate right. This is a solution. It's correct. It passed the test suites. The person who wrote this got full credit. I think we can make this better. So modular arithmetic is clearly something that's new to many of you. And one trick, one thing to keep in mind when you're doing the modular arithmetic is just a rule of thumb, is that you typically only ever need to apply the modulus once. To keep something in bounds, to keep it within the bound of the array. Here you can already see that we're applying the modulus twice. So I'm applying it once on line 8, and again, I'm applying it again here on line 12. Okay? Also, frequently, modular arithmetic allows me to avoid this kind of special case down here that I have inside my loop, where I've got this if statement. One of the reasons I'm looking at this example is because this looks similar to a lot of the things I've seen people trying to do on MP1. All right? Okay, so let's see if we can slim this down a little bit and get it to the point where we don't have to apply the modulus more than one time. So I'm also selectively applying the modulus here. So I'm creating this, the solution creates this value called rotator that's a copy of rotate. And then if rotator's too big, then it applies the modulus. But I don't need to do that. You know, this if statement really has no effect. It's safe to apply a modulus to something that's smaller than the modulus. You just get the same number back. Okay? So this I can remove. Just do that. So that's one simplification. Now, as I go through the array, so this is, you know, a perfect example of how to iterate through this array. Not sure why, so I would probably do this. I would probably change this to letters since I've converted my original string to a series of characters at this point. So I have a series of letters. So let's think about if we can apply the modulus once. So the current position is I. So the rotated position, so if I do, let's say, int new position, let's set that equal to I to begin with. Then let's add our rotation. Say new position plus equals rotate. Now, of course, rotate might be really big. Rotate might have taken me way past the bound of the array. So what do I do to get back inside? How do I do that? That's where I apply my modulus, right? That's what's going to, you know, cause this looping behavior. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to say new position is equal to, and I can actually do this all in one go, I'll say new position is equal to I plus rotate modulo letters dot length. That's it. That is correctly calculated the rotate position for this character that I'm looking at. So now all I really need to do here is set letters at I to, actually, hold on a sec. Let's do this. I also need an output array here. So let's do, let's do a little bit more cleanup here. So I like using a name like input, right? Let's get an input array by converting input to char array. I'm not going to need rotator anymore because I'm doing this inside the loop. Let's say char output array is equal to new char input array dot length. And you know what? Let's call this return array. This is one of my, I like prefixing variable names with the return. That way I know what I'm doing with them. This is what I'm going to hand back. I'm going through, I'm calculating the new position, and then all I'm doing is I'm saying return array new position is equal to input array I. None of this I need. And then I had the correct incantation here to return the array. So this is a solution. This is, from the perspective of modular arithmetic, this is probably the cleanest solution. Could you make this a little bit trimmer? Yeah, you could. You could move this math in here. So I could do this. I don't need a separate array variable. I think maybe it's even a little cleaner to do this. If I needed to print off the new position to make sure that it was working properly, I'd be able to do that.